Hey guys, so if you're new here, or if you're not, if you want to hear me voice act, head over to our main channel, links down below. And if you don't, this channel's solely for TTS. If you want to know all the details about what's going on, we have a stream up that you can go and watch, but let's just get into the video.
Alpharius. No such Primarch exists. Please redirect yourself to the main page. No, seriously. Alpharius, also known as the Last Primarch, Lord of Serpents, the Head of the Hydra, Lorem Ipsum, Anonymous and I am Alpharius, was the mysterious Primarch of the Alpha Legion. We don't have much information on him other than that Omegon, his twin brother, looks identical to Alpharius. During the Alpha Legion assault on Pluto, Alpharius dueled Rogel and was killed. However, he was supposedly killed by Robout Gilliman of the Ultramarines again, but it may be Omegon who Gilliman killed. Alpharius was the last Primarch found by the Emperor, long after the Emperor had established most of the Space Marine Legions, and was in the process of reclaiming the galaxy for humanity. Whilst most of the Primarchs wound up on worlds in Imperial space, Alpharius wound up picked up by derelicts from some unknown world and grew into a space pirate, long before Huron Blackheart made it cool. One day, on a patrol in a no-name system, Quora Strike Group came under attack by pirate forces, mostly small, and ancient by modern standards, fighter craft. The attack was carefully staged, and the pirates managed to cripple one of the advanced ships the fleet had, which forced Horus to move his own ship in to do something about it. When Horus managed to board the advanced ship with his retinue, he was shocked to learn that a small team of pirates had somehow gotten on board and were fighting their way to the bridge. Fighting their way past the chapter serfs, a squad of five burst into the bridge, whereupon Horus opened fire with his combi bolter. Four were taken down by Horus suppressing fire, but the fifth one, who towered over even the Space Marines and Horus' retinue, dodged Horus' barrage and continued to advance regardless of the oncoming fire. It was only when Alpharius got to close range that he stopped his Aversa-esque charge, as both he and Horus immediately recognized the physical similarity between the two. Horus smiled, for he had found the last of his missing brothers. Just as planned. Or it would be. But unfortunately, this story is a lie. In any case, Horus did not immediately send Alpharius back to Terra. Instead, he kept Alpharius around for months, showing him how to get shit done. Alpharius quickly formed a pretty strong bond with Horus, since he seemed like a pretty cool guy who killed aliens and wasn't afraid of anything, and Alpharius and his men quickly adopted the Imperial Creed. Horus was greatly impressed with Alpharius' skill, though Alpharius trolled Horus mercilessly by refusing to tell Horus what world he was from, and instead denied that any of the worlds Horus captured and brought into Imperial compliance were his point of origin. The Emperor was pleased when Alpharius was finally found, but by this point, there wasn't much time for celebrations. The Great Crusade was in full swing. Alpharius was given command of the newly formed 20th Space Marine Legion, dubbed the Alpha Legion, and proceeded to get to work. This is without the memes. OTG. Close bracket. But wait. The above account is considered the most well-known by far TGUIS and the gaming community in general, but recorded facts tell varying different stories. The Horus Heresy series of books suggests that the above origin story is a lie and gives three more discovery tales about Alpharius, then goes on to assert that they are all lies too, but that they contain grains of truth that could lead to an even greater secret. These are 1. Growing up on a dead world with absolutely no one to raise and educate him, only escaping by commandeering a Xenos vessel that had landed to plunder the planet's ruins. He then left to discover who made him. But this story is a lie. 2. Landing on a human world and living amongst them for 10 years, but the planet is then attacked by the Slorgth, who kept him as a curiosity and killed the remainder of the population. Alpharius would be saved by the Emperor directly but kept him hidden from public knowledge for many years while his son was rehabilitated. But this story is a lie. 3. Alpharius was not fully completed at the time of the scattering of the Primarchs, thus was spared or some part of him remained behind, potentially Omegon? Dot. Either way, he remained at the Emperor's side at the beginning of the Great Crusade and acted as his hidden agent until the time was right to reveal him. But this story is a lie. In Alpharius, Head of the Hydra, the author uses all of these, to one degree or another. Alpharius was found on Terra and raised in secret, because the Emperor wasn't sure how many Primarchs had survived the scattering. 3. He spends much of the Great Crusade waging a shadow war against the enemies of the Imperium, until he hears about a warrior that sounds like a Primarch and goes to investigate. The warrior, revealed to be Omegan, is trapped on a dead, Sloggth-infested world. 2. However, he hasn't been tortured or corrupted by the Sloggth. Omegan tells Alpharius that he wound up on a dead world and escaped by hijacking some space pirates when they came to loot the place. 1. Before getting trapped on this planet while killing Sloggth. Eventually, the two decide to go introduce themselves to Horus, and Omegan proceeds to attack the vengeful spirit, infiltrate it, and reveal himself to Horus as Alpharius. Therefore, every Alpha Legion origin has some level of truth. Well played, Black Library. On top of that, it was Alpharius who had the Slayed Grey Armor and infiltrated each of his brother's legions when they were introduced to their fathers, while Omegan was the one in the Pythian scales with the Pale Spear when Alpharius found him. The fact that the prologue and the epilogue both feature Alpharius stating "I am Alpharius," followed by the statement "this is" was a lie, makes it even more confusing as to which twin is which. Indeed, it's entirely possible that the entire novel is a lie. What this suggests, if all four stories are true and taken into context, is that the twins were separated at the scattering, with one landing on a separate planet, the human world becoming the dead world when the Xenos arrived, and was then raised by Xenos, but escaped, or was rescued, and attempted to search for his creator, finding Horus. While the one grew up in secrecy with the Emperor and accounts for much of the actions of the XXTH Legion long before the Primarch's official discovery. This is supported in both the short stories, First Legion and The Last Council. In the former, an individual calling himself Alpharius from the XXTH Legion comes to the aid of Lionel Jensen during the Rangdon Xenocides, nearly 90 years before Alpharius was officially discovered and the Alpha Legion was given its name. In the latter, Alpharius informs Horus about Malkada's plan to commit Damnatio Memoriae on one of the 2nd or 11th Legion's Primarchs, but considering that both of the 2nd and 11th were dead and condemned by 963 M30, and Alpharius didn't, officially, join the Great Crusade until 981 M30. Granted, in each story neither of the individuals may be one of the twin Primarchs and the Primarch simply took the name after they were eventually recovered. But it shows that someone called Alpharius was active before his official discovery, certainly adding fuel to the fire that one of the twins was in the service of the Emperor long before his counterpart was picked up at the end of the Great Crusade. The fact that one of the twins is loyal to the Emperor while the other isn't, is supported in Vengeful Spirit by Graham McNeil. During a conversation between Malkada and the Emperor, Malkada reveals that the Dark Angels had come to the aid of Lemon Russ and the Space Wolves against the Alpha Legion, to which the Emperor replies, "Alpharius, my son, what chance did you give my dream?" Indicates that the Emperor is either unaware that Alpharius Omegan is actually two twin Primarchs, which seems unlikely given his whole creation of them using parts of his godlike power and psyche, or that he is aware of their dual nature but knows that the other twin would never turn on him. This is practically confirmed in the short story The Board Is Set, wherein the allegorical game of strategy is used to represent the outcomes of the Primarch's destinies. There were two pieces for the twins, one red and one blue, representing their chosen side in the conflict. It also showed that at least some of the actions of the Emperor were done in order to ensure that the blue twin did not switch sides and cause an overall chaos victory. This means that the Emperor and Malkada were both fully aware of the nature of the twin Primarchs, if not their exact whereabouts and activities, as well as knowing that they were at odds with one another and striving to ensure that one of them remained loyal. No tabletop RPG is complete without beautiful models on the table, and the best place to get models is from us. If you check the link below, we have everything you could need for your magical realm. Only the finest of big titty wafers here. But if you're not into models or don't play with models, we got you covered with subclasses such as the Gachimashi Wizards, the Simp Warlock, and the North FC Fighter. Also, we have started selling 5th edition adventures, with our first one featuring Belle Delphine, the succubus that has poisoned the town's well and turned the villagers into simps. If any of that stuff sounds fun to you, go ahead and check the link below, but let's get back to the video. Great Crusade. Alpharius, unusual for the Primarchs, developed a different approach to his missions, focusing primarily on flexibility and personal initiative and making extensive use of subterfuge and non-astart specialist operatives. This was reflected with the Alpha Legion symbol, a Hydra, which could strike from multiple directions at once, and which could keep going even with the loss of a head. This multiple fronts, seemingly unstructured approach towards warfare, naturally, pissed off Robout Gilliman, who Alpharius refused to recognize as his spiritual liege, and Gilliman openly called Alpharius' tactics cowardly. Unlike most similar arguments, such as between the Lion and Lemon Russ, this one turned violent in record time when Gilliman pointed to the Ultramarine's own record, something Alpharius could never hope to achieve, since Gilliman had a 100-year head start on the Alpha Legion, which is partly false since the XXTH Ghost Legion had existed since the early years of the Great Crusade and done the Emperor's wet work in secret, though Gilliman probably wouldn't have known that. This might sting even more if the twins were separated, as one of the origin stories suggest, and one of them was actually were in command of the Ghost Legion decades before Gilliman's discovery, meaning that Alpharius Omegan could have actually had the head start. Determined to prove he was an infinitely better commander than Gilliman could hope to be, Alpharius took his forces and went on their very first assignment, a world that had thrown off Imperial rule, and was openly stating its intention to fight off Imperial forces. Rather than land immediately and bring the world to heel through force, Alpharius delayed, and the world fortified heavily. By this point, some 2 million PDF troopers stood ready to repulse the Space Marine invasion. It was only now that Alpharius struck. By taking advantage of and equipping Imperial loyal citizens on the planet, Alpharius' forces managed to cause several diversionary attacks that drew the PDF away from their held locations, before a series of bombings cut them off, and the Alpha Legion cut the power to the city's central hive. Within a week, Alpharius had subjugated the world, having lost less than 36 Space Marines in the process. Beaming with pride at his accomplishments, Alpharius returned to a meeting with his brothers with all the smug satisfaction of a Dark Heresy player that had just derailed his GM's campaign. What he got was not what he expected. Instead of praising him, Gilliman rebuked him pretty harshly, claiming that Alpharius' method had been a waste of time, effort, and the Emperor's bolt shells. The reason was that, while Gilliman certainly could appreciate the masterful organization and lack of casualties, he was an empire builder and looked beyond immediate conquest and compliance. Gilliman knew that leaving planets conquered but in ruins made for difficulty in rebuilding afterwards, and that it costed more effort and pain in the long run than a more strictly clinical alpha strike, and that direct approaches, like he had his own ultramarines do whenever possible, left planets in a better state to use and integrate in the Imperium once the ass-kicking was done. Ultrasmurf style was meant to inspire respect and make it easier to build rebuild support for the Emperor, instead of leaving a traumatized, resentful population. Alpharius' stratagems had indeed spared Space Marine lives, but in doing so had totaled the rebels' infrastructure, which seriously hurt the civilian population and would cost the Imperium much larger amounts of resources to set the planet back on its feet than if he'd gone in openly and just punched the fuckers in the face. Alpharius was likewise admonished by Rogaldorn, who, while acknowledging the sheer magnitude of what Alpharius had accomplished, dismissed his methods as unmanly in that his legion were not fit to bear the Emperor's mark because of the harm it did to the civilians on the planet. He didn't get on well with Mortarion or Russ either, coming close to conflict due to his lack of adherence to battlefield commands, though it seems the Lord of the Death Guard rubs everyone up the wrong way. Magnus and his thousand sons went out of their way to avoid Alpharius wherever possible, but for unreported reasons. Rotten cherry on top of an already spoiled cake, even fucking Conrad Kurz openly mocked Alpharius and his legion for hiding his sins in a shroud of lies. Yeah, because he never hid anything, the bloody prison rapist that he is. Wait, actually he didn't. He displayed his kills openly and broadcast that shit all over the place for all to see and fear. Close bracket. Suffice to say, Alpharius was fucking pissed. Many argue he was simply unlucky. Had he been on the other side of the galaxy at the time, he would have likely hooked up with other brothers who may have been not only impressed with Alpharius' stunning accomplishment, but likely would have noted it for their own tactical use later and taught him to think about preserving non-combatant lives while he was at it. Though it was noted, with a hint of surprise, that Alpharius successfully campaigned briefly with the Lion and Ferris Manus without incident. It's unfortunate that they never got the chance to fight side by side with Korax or even better, Vulcan. Not only is Vulcan the bro-inest Primarch, who not even Mortarion or Kurz could hate, Vulcan was one of the Primarchs who firmly instilled the creed of mortals are people too. They don't have our strength, speed or wisdom. They do the best they can with what they have. Look after them. Meaning he and Alpharius would have gotten on like a house on fire. But yeah, sadly enough, Alpharius got chewed up by the stuck-ups and fed up with his available brothers being butthurt. He took off, believing fervently, and pretty accurately, that Gilliman hated him. Important note: some or potentially all of this may well be old fluff. We've learned a lot about Alpharius in recent years, as well as getting a more personal picture of the others in this story really does not fit with either of them. We know now that Alpharius was working for the Cabal and thus didn't join Horus because he was pissed or anything. In fact, he was working against Horus, so this squabbly stuff doesn't really fit. Perhaps Alpharius wanted to appear bitter and resentful and a natural choice for Horus to recruit, but that's clearly not the whole truth. On top of that, the spat with Gilliman doesn't sound like the Gilliman we've seen in the books. His own writings specifically say that whatever wins the battle is the right strategy, and as a master of logistics, it seems weird for Gilliman to bitch about Alpharius winning by using the least resources possible. Maybe he thought Alpharius took too long or left the planet ripe for another rebellion, but that's not the same as calling him a coward. On top of that, given that a legion like the World Eaters or Iron Warriors would probably have butchered every single person on the planet in a rave orgy of blood and death, calling a more restrained approach cowardly just doesn't fit. It maybe sounds like Dawn to be pissed off for not developing and fortifying the worlds Alpharius conquered, but only the Imperial Fists, Word Bearers and Ultramarines really did that, the other legions leaving it to the Imperials following behind them to rebuild stuff. Whether Alpharius was playing up the rift to ensure Horus came calling or if this is just totally out of date is unknown, but it's safe to say that this stuff isn't the whole truth. Just as planned. Horus Heresy. When Horus turned to chaos during the Horus Heresy, Alpharius really had only met one brother who had not treated him like shit, and that was Horus, so it comes as no surprise that Alpharius followed Horus' descent into chaos. Actually, this is another lie. The real reason Alpharius joined the Warmaster was because a cabal of Xenos showed him that if Horus won, then chaos would be defeated, but only due to all of humanity stop feeding war power to chaos by the virtue of everyone being dead. Hence the Alpha Legion is all a bunch of closet loyalists, Malol worshippers. Seriously, they are chaos worshippers trying to kill chaos. So, double traitors? But unlike double heresy, it's like a double negative? Comma could just be that Alpharius preferred the future that ensured humanity's continued existence rather than the one that had humanity go extinct at the hands of a victorious Horus, pro-humanity. Alpharius also engages in a friendly bit of legion purging in the book The Seventh Serpent. He masquerades as Shadwick Medicine of the Iron Hands and sways Captain Cadmus Tyro and the ship Sisyphium starring Savage Wayland and Nakona Shirokin to destroy the loyalist Alpha Legion strike cruiser Sigma led by Legate Chaitin during ship refueling operations under the pretense of striking at Alpharius. The Prometheum fuel was sabotaged and the entire ship becomes an enormous bomb. Said bomb exploding on the suborbital refueling depot Lerna 212 while Iron Hands are still on it, killing more loyalists among the Iron Hands too. What a dick. Engages in more mindfuckery during the ensuing fight with Nakona and spares his life when he says that Magnus asked him to, seeding doubt in the Iron Hands. Just as planned. But there was more. As it turns out, Alpharius' greatest secret was not his homeworld. It was that he had an identical twin, named Omegan. It is not clear if the Emperor intended this, nor was he even aware of it. Alpharius and Omegan are, in fact, both the Primarch of the Alpha Legion, although Alpharius is the public face and appears as the more senior of the two. Both look alike, however, and the two switch their roles often. Alpha Legion Marines have described this well-kept secret as the pair sharing one soul between two bodies, and the other Primarchs, unaware of the Alpha Legion Primarch's true nature, simply believed they were one person, named, appropriately enough, Alpharius Omegan. The only true way to tell the difference between the two was their armor, with Omegan's being all black due to his role as a stealth specialist. Whichever one you thought you weren't looking at, it was the other one. In addition to this, it's rumored that Alpharius, or Omegan, or both of them, or someone, maybe. My head hurts. Okay. Back on track. It's rumored that someone had several of the Alpha Legion Marines surgically altered to look exactly like them so they could stand in as extra body doubles if when it was needed. This was easier for the Alphas than it would have been for any other Legion, because some Alpha Legionnaires were unusually freakishly tall, and their Primarchs were the shortest of the bunch, rather than being giants with one eye, wings, and or metal hands. It also helped that digesting a small portion of their Primarch's blood made those body doubles powerful enough to be mistaken as true Primarchs not only by appearance but also by their combat prowess for quite a long time, up to several hours. Although it isn't known if this were a common ability amongst Alpha Legionnaires, or was it artificially engineered only for the body doubles. It's unknown if Gilliman killed Omegan, or simply some dipshit Alpha Legion Marine who decided to pull a Spartacus and pose as them. Or neither. So you can see where the memes come from. Who the hell did Gilliman kill? Maybe the whole war on Escrida was a big chunk of disinformation trolling made by Alpha Legion agents to fake their Primarch's death. Or they want the Inquisition to think so. After all, the only source of information about said war was Inquisitor Kravin's report, who mysteriously disappeared shortly after and may or may not be an Alpha Legion agent undercover. That being said, the Ultramarines have no records about the Escrida War, but again those records may or may not be lost or may not be destroyed due to some Alpha Legion black ops. Or just lost due to shitty Imperial record keeping, as it would not be the first time that's happened. And to keep up the mystery, when Gregor Eisenhorn needed someone to keep Elizabeth Bequin's clone Elizabeth Beta Bequin safe, he got someone whose only response was "I am Alpharius and can make an Emperor's Children Space Marine run away just by showing his face." Goddammit, this is confusing. It gets worse. A short story printed in the Primarch's Horus Heresy book shows that by drinking the Primarch's blood, an Alpha Legion Marine took on the genetic coding of the Primarchs, fooling even the apothecary on the mission. Also at the end, Alpharius and Omegan are speaking about the necessities of war, as the mission before was a one-way trip, including the death of a rogue Sicker who became close to Omegan. Omegan seemed to think the sacrifice was not necessary, whilst Alpharius believed it was, hinting that the brothers were not in agreement on all things. As their plan in Legion relied on killing off humanity to kill off chaos, Omegan is probably looking for another option. This may or may not mean the Alpha Legion has some connection to the Purge, but as with all other things on this page, nobody fucking knows. It is notable that in Deliverance Lost, the Alpha Legion betrayed even the Cabal. And the third Forge World Horus Heresy book includes a large story which ended with Alpharius, or was it? Commerce screwing over Horus by not garrisoning an area after the Alpha Legion conquered it. At this point, combined with how even Alpharius and Omegan don't seem to agree, it's questionable if the Alpha Legion is even unified in its purpose. They wouldn't be the only ones divided over betraying the Imperium. Rural is a great app available on the Apple and Google Play Store, as well as desktop, for creating beautiful 8-bit character art. The app has 14 supported races, 150 plus weapons, 400 plus armor pieces for you to mix and match, 20 plus mini bases. There is that much to work from. I was able to make Coldsteel the Hedgehog, the God Emperor of Mankind, Pepe, and they are always adding more artwork. The app also has a character sheet to help keep track of everything during games. And if that wasn't enough, you can play about with the app for free with limited artwork. So go ahead, check it out, and if you decide to buy the app, use promo code NICKBEARDIA for 10% off, and it lets them know we sent you. It's a great sponsor and a great app, and we hope you guys go ahead and check it. But let's get back to the video. Death. In Praetorians of Dawn, it was revealed that the blood memory method thing that Shid Ranko used to become Omegan wasn't the only way for a Primarch to operate outside of their bodies. The Legion possessed Sickers with the ability to transfer the consciousness of a Primarch into a legionary. However, all speculation above may now be moot. In the same book, Alpharius himself, apparently not a proxy, having been pulling shit no mere legionary's body could have done, led an attack on the Sol system. Dawn tanks a shot in his shoulder to pin Alpharius in place, then ripped his skull apart with his big ass chain sword. Alpharius is actually dead. Omegan, half the galaxy away, sensed it and decided to adopt Alpharius's identity permanently. Actually, Alpharius has his psyche reconstructed to resemble that of the Legion Hero Master, Silonius. He does this to mask his presence on Terra from the Emperor, Malkader and company. Alpharius actually physically goes into the fight. He slowly unlocks his mental blocks as the Legion's plan reaches its climax. Then he ambushes, and subsequently tries to reason with or confuse Dawn, who ignores everything and proceeds to shred Alpharius' body. Yeah. He dead. Close bracket. This is unlikely with the kinds of shit the Alpha Legion pull all the time, but we will let the Imperial Fister who wrote the last paragraph keep seeing the world in black and white. Or should I say yellow and teal? Nope, Og is right. Alpharius is roadkill. John French has confirmed it in an interview, in 30, 35, 31, 30, and Omegan felt his brother's death. That's the cool thing about this book. It shows us that the Alpha Legion is smart as fuck but ain't invincible. Just as planned can get tiring when you have too many twist, turns and loop-de-loops like these two clowns insist on doing. Whilst Alpharius is super dead from the whole Pluto thing, there is yet another account from of Alpharius dying that is less known. In the short story Hunter's Moon, a space wolf named Torbjorn, insert shitty Overwatch meme here, details how he killed Alpharius by arriving on his ship peacefully and then shooting him in the head. Okay, it wasn't that simple. He arrived on the ship for some diplomacy stuff and to verify if the Alpha Legion were super traitor heretics or not. Basically, the Space Wolf squad was there to guard Alpharius in case he did go traitor so they could murder the fuck out of him the moment they turned. Alpharius saw right through that shit, because duh, but he was still playing along. Then Alpharius asked them to kneel. Unfortunately for all parties involved, space wolves are very stubborn regarding such things. Then Alpharius threw a stupid babby hissy fit about them and their rightful burning of Prospero. As Torbjorn is the speaker, we know that he isn't the most reliable source as the entire story rings of space wolf propaganda, but we do know that the events do seem to have happened as he said. But most likely the ignoble and rash Alpharius was probably just pointing out just how fucking stupid destroying an entire loyal legion and then being self-righteous about it is. Anyway, Alpha Legion fan wonkery aside, the two groups broke into battle. Alpharius then killed some space wolves and CQC and then got shot in the face dead by Torbjorn. Torbjorn then jacked an Alpha Legion ship and fled to the planet they were orbiting, Pelago. He then told the story to some fishermen and noted he would likely either be found by Alpha Legion or Space Wolf forces very soon since he put out a distress call. A few hours of sailing later, a Space Wolf stormbird appeared from the sky, to Torbjorn's brief delight, opened the back door revealing Alpharius to Torbjorn's confusion as he was notably not dead and had his skull perfectly intact and unblemished, and then the Alpha Legion murdered Torbjorn and two of the three sailors, leaving one alive. This was likely to seed fear of the Alpha Legion into Pelago because the Alpha Legion loves mind games. What the point was of taking the effort to repaint a stormbird was as debatable, but perhaps Alpharius just wanted to see the look on his face. Now we have three stories of Alpharius' death. On Pluto, where he certainly did bite the dust, on Pelago where he certainly didn't, and on Escrida, where it might have been Omegan who was killed. Or we can apply some common sense and realize there is no way in hell shooting a Primarch in the head would kill him. Probably not even hurt him. Hell, there are stories of normal astards shrugging off bolt gun headshots. In any case, with his Legion's ability to transfer memories and consciousness, even if their physical bodies are well and truly dead, the Primarch's minds may be fragmented throughout the members of the Legion and influencing them to the point that it becomes impossible to say where legionaries end and their Primarch begins. Again. Meter. To cap this fuckfest of a conspiracy off, there also appears to be an Alpha Legion Chaos Lord claiming to be none other than the big man himself, even sending all six of his would-be Vindicare assassins' heads into the food storage halls of the fucking High Lords on Terra. In conclusion, one of the twin Primarchs of the Alpha Legion died at the Battle of Pluto during the opening phase of the Solar War, the prelude to the Siege of Terra itself. Which Primarch died exactly? Yes. The big reveal. Head of the Hydra finally established the true story of Alpharius. Alpharius was in fact the first Primarch found, on a world within a stone's toss of Terra, possibly on Terra itself. Since the people who find him know what the Imperium is, and he was apparently found prior to the end of the Unification War, meaning the Emperor hadn't yet left Terra. His discovery was kept hidden from everyone except Emps, Malkada, and Valda, as the Emperor didn't know how many other Primarchs had survived the scattering. Alpharius was placed into Malkada daycare, explains a lot, while Big E went around doing Big E things, and acted as the head of the Shadow Legion, using wet work teams, psyops, and deep cover sleeper agents to maintain order on compliant worlds and soften up non-compliant planets for his brother's legions. He also apparently infiltrated some of the other legions by using his ability to alter others' perception of him, thus meeting several of his brothers at their rediscovery while disguised as one of their legion. Alpharius eventually discovered Omegan already wearing the Pythian scales and wielding the Pale Spear, and the two agreed to keep their existence hidden until all the remaining Primarchs were found. It was Omegan who revealed himself to Horus aboard the Vengeful Spirit and introduced himself with "I am Alpharius," making this line a lie, since he's actually Omegan. While Alpharius kept his existence hidden and operated as Omegan. At the end of the novel, when Omegan feels that Alpharius had been killed by Dawn, he states, "I was Alpharius," which is a lie because he had been Omegan. Who in turn turns out to be Alpharius all along. Wrap your head around that. The novel all but states that at least Alpharius was loyal all along, and that every action he took throughout the heresy was designed to make Chaos lose without blowing the Legion's cover. Alpharius had been given a directive by the Emperor to ensure the survival of the Imperium at all costs, including taking actions that might look like treason to the outside observer. This would include doing things like intentionally botching conquests to make planetary campaigns tie up more resources, delaying the Khan so he could receive the message to return to Terra, and prematurely exposing all of the vulnerabilities that the Alpha Legion had found in Terra's defenses and Praetorian of Dawn long before Horus showed up in an elaborate blood game, which Alpharius invented, so they could be remedied. This all ironically makes him one of the most loyal Primarchs amongst his brothers. Tabletop. While not a monster of close combat like other Primarchs, Alpharius gives candy to his army while fucking with the opponents like no one but him can. That being said, even the worst of combat Primarchs will hump just about anything else. Sire of the Alpha Legion grants all Alpha Legion units preferred enemy, everything, and gives Alpharius preferred enemy, everything, counterattack, move through cover, scout, and crusader, but not right away. You see, after both sides deploy, he can opt out of deploying normally or via deep striking and choose to hide in any Alpha Legion infantry unit which is part of the primary detachment, disguised as a rank and file model, but can reveal himself starting at turn 2, and does so automatically at turn 5, replacing a model and gaining all of the above buffs. If the unit he's hiding in is falling back when he reveals himself, it auto-rallies, and if it's destroyed while he's still hiding, or if it is in a transport and there is no space for him, he just goes into reserves. You must write which unit is hiding Alpharius. But if you're a true Alpha Legionnaire, you'd have 6 different notes, none of them with your actual handwriting style. Be careful though, remember that he is bulky and that he can only be revealed at the beginning of your own turn, so if he is hiding in a transport at full capacity, he could be impossible to place. For example, in a 10-man breacher squad inside a rhino, unless you already disembarked the squad on the previous turn, so plan accordingly. He can also seize the initiative on a 4+, give units arriving via outflank a plus D3 movement bonus, and, best of all, if an enemy unit is successfully brought in from reserves and your army has an identical version of that same type also in reserve, roll a D6, on a 4+, the opponent brings in your unit instead. Combine him with his legion row to almost guarantee going first and almost completely negate your enemy's reserves. As far as equipment goes, on defense, the Pythian Scales gives him 2+ armor save and 4+ invulnerable save and also ignores the effects of poison and flesh bane. Not bad. His weapon, The pale spear doesn't boost his strength, but it does add up 1, armor bane, and instant death along with two-handed. As an interesting note, this actually makes him one of the best Primarchs for murdering monsters. He is one of the few Primarchs with access to instant death without a proc from a dice roll. He could reasonably take out a trio of Carnifex in a single round of CQC, or more topically, a squad of Tagmata. He also has the following equipment: Venom Spheres, Mastercrafted Plasma Blaster, Cognus Signum, Nuncio Vox and Camellia Line, making him quite the force multiplier and perfectly capable to adapt to a variety of circumstances, like he should be. All in all, Alpharius is one of the, if not flat out the single best force multiplier in Warhammer 30k, as his value for money only increases the larger battles get. In 3000 points games, stubborn and other once per game abilities are useful. At 1000 points they are less so. Preferred enemy, everything, is universally useful and becomes more useful the larger the armies become. Seriously, you'd happily pay 415 points to give your Apocalypse Army preferred enemy anyway, never mind that you're also getting a Primarch as well. Alpharius vs other Primarchs. Primarch fighting, while fun to see, isn't a very competitive thing to do as it'll usually tie up both Primarchs for the entire game without either of them dying. With that in mind, this section is about how Alpharius fares against other Primarchs mathhammer-wise. Please note that all the various abilities are taken into account when possible and the matchups assume the Primarchs are the only ones involved in the fighting, so various abilities like Engrand's the Butcher's Nails and Rampage do not provide any bonuses. In essence, the fights are supposed to happen in a vacuum for simplicity, but notes are added to make things clearer in particular instances. Also, all of the Primarch use their most powerful weapons, because why have a contest if you don't do your best? Well guys, hope you enjoy today's video. We are going to assume you have if you have stayed to the end. Consider subscribing and clicking the notification bell if you really enjoyed it to stay up to speed with any and all new videos. Also check out the links below to our shop for some fat ass titties and our sponsor Rural, and be sure to use a promo code at checkout so they know we sent you and you'll get 10% off. And until next time.